This lecture will focus on the cardiovascular system, one of 12 or so major organ systems in your body. The cardiovascular system is the primary transportation system within your body. When glucose travels around in your body from your liver to your toe, for example, it's your cardiovascular system that's responsible. When oxygen travels from your heart to your brain, it's the cardiovascular system that's responsible for that transport also. The two basic components of the cardiovascular system are the heart, which is the centralized pump, and then miles and miles of hollow tubes that carry blood that we technically know as blood vessels, or veins, arteries, capillaries, and several other different types. Today we're going to focus primarily on the heart. In order to understand the heart, we're going to have to understand first of all what the heart is made of. All organs in your body are made up of small living units called cells. The heart is completely made up of living cells known as cardiac muscle cells. These cells are unique because they're found nowhere else in the body. Cardiac muscle cells, like most muscle cells, have the ability to shorten or contract. There are, however, several properties that make cardiac muscle cells relatively unique. First of all, cardiovascular muscle cells are said to be autorhythmic. That's a special property that means they can generate their own action potential or own electrical activity without relying on the brain or the spinal cord. For example, if a heart is removed during a heart transplant operation, the heart will continue to beat after all connections are severed. We'll talk about this autorhythmicity in a moment. Cardiovascular cells are also able to stimulate adjacent cells. For example, to activate all of the cells in the heart, all of the millions of cells in the heart, it's only necessary to stimulate two or three of them. These waves of action potentials or waves of electrical current can travel to adjacent cells. The heart is a round organ, roughly the size of a small grapefruit, and it contains four hollow spaces internally. The walls of the heart are made up of these cardiovascular muscle cells, but the internal chambers are known as atria or ventricles. The heart has a couple of different primary functions. It will receive blood that's deoxygenated, that's flowing from the brain, for example, or from the pancreas, or from your little toe. The heart will then send that blood up to your lungs so it can saturate itself with oxygen. Blood will return to the heart, and last but not least, the heart has the responsibility of sending this oxygenated blood out to every single tissue in the body. Deoxygenated blood enters the right side of the heart in the small upper chamber called the right atrium, and you can see that on the page that I've handed out. Deoxygenated blood flows from the right atrium down through a small one-way valve into the right ventricle. Throughout the heart, we're going to find these little one-way stop-and-go systems that are essential for ensuring blood travels in one direction. Deoxygenated blood then flows from the larger right ventricle up to the lungs through a pulmonary trunk, which is essentially an artery because it carries blood away from the body, but it's unlike most arteries because it carries deoxygenated or bad blood. The pulmonary arteries will carry blood up to the lungs, where the blood will circulate in lung tissue and become saturated with oxygen. This is also called the pulmonary loop, as opposed to a systemic loop, which would be any other organ or tissue in your body. After blood spends a few moments in the lungs, it returns to the heart, except on the left side, and it enters a small upper left atrium. The blood is going to return through structures called veins, although these are going to be unlike other veins that usually carry poor blood. The blood that returns to the left atrium from the lungs is the absolute most oxygen-rich blood you have in your body. From the smaller right atrium, blood is going to be pumped down through another valve into the biggest chamber of your heart, known as the left ventricle. The small valve that protects and ensures that blood flows down from the atrium into the ventricle is also known as the bicuspid or mitral valve. Oftentimes, because this valve is experiencing great pressure, this valve will give way and blood can actually flow in the opposite direction, which is relatively dangerous in some cases, but is also known as a heart murmur. Once oxygenated blood is in the left atrium. It flows down, once again, through the bicuspid valve into the left ventricle. The left ventricle has the most muscle of any of the chambers. It's got the responsibility of getting blood out to the rest of the body. All of your 5 trillion cells absolutely rely on the ability of this chamber to contract. When the left ventricle contracts, it forces blood up and out through a small valve into the largest blood vessel in your body, known as the aorta. The aorta is then going to send branches up to your brain. The aorta will then send branches down through your thoracic cavity and eventually down into your legs. The aorta is the largest artery in your body, and it contains oxygenated blood. So we've got 4 chambers that work together to push blood in very specific fashion. We really have to worry about now how we regulate those chambers. If the atria and the ventricle decided to contract independently, blood would not flow effectively, and we'd end up with a big mess. The cells in the heart are controlled by the cardiac conduction system. The cardiac conduction system consists of several specialized cardiac muscle cells that function only to carry information. These cells, unlike true cardiac muscle cells, do not contract. In a sense, they're modified nerves or modified circuits. The primary controller of heart function will be called the sinoatrial node. The sinoatrial node is also sometimes called the pacemaker, and it's found in the upper corner of the right atrium. It's going to be in the upper right corner of your heart. About 100 times per minute, special autorhythmic cells in the sinoatrial node generate impulses. Every time one of these impulses is generated, the impulse is carried through the heart by all of the cells. If you remember, we said that the cardiac muscle cells had that property of being able to stimulate adjacent cells. When the sinoatrial node fires or generates an impulse, because it's closest to the atria, both atria contract almost simultaneously. The two top chambers of the heart work as a unit. When the right atrium contracts, it forces blood into the right ventricle. When the left atrium contracts, it forces blood into the left ventricle. So simultaneously, blood is flowing from the top of the heart into the bottom of the heart. A split second later, a small delay occurs, and this delay is going to be caused by insulating material. It's going to be most effective to have the heart contract as 2 separate units, a top unit and a bottom unit. In order to delay slightly the spread of impulses from the atria to the ventricles, there is a layer of connective tissue between the top half of the heart and the bottom half of the heart that essentially prevents impulses from traveling. However, in order for the cells in the ventricles to be active, they must receive a signal, and this signal will ultimately come by way of the atrioventricular node. Basically, in the geographical center of the heart, there's a small group of cells that will collect impulses that have been delivered from the pacemaker and direct these impulses down into the larger ventricles. The atrioventricular node sends impulses down through a specialized branch of cells that looks like a small cluster called the atrioventricular bundle. Oftentimes, these bundles do not operate properly, and you end up with what's called a branch bundle block. If these branches in any way become hindered or inactivated, certain regions of the heart cannot be stimulated. Last but not least, from the atrioventricular bundle, impulses are delivered to the discrete minute tissues in the bottom of the ventricles through small microscopic fibers called Purkinje fibers.